morning, Orchard Crest. Hey, what's happened? This side has got bigger than that side over there. Now, y'all going to have to really get to work now. We're going to have a cheering set. No, I'm teasing.
This is Southern Baptist, and that's the Northern Baptist.
Oh, Southern and Northern Baptist. Well, we'll do away with both of those and say that we are one in Christ. We are one in Christ. It's so good to see you today. Thank you for coming, those of you that are visiting with us. If you've been here more than once, I just consider you as home folks. So whether you've joined yet or not, but if you're looking for a church, we certainly are open for that. The requirement is that you've been washed in the blood and then held about that long under water and up. Water don't save you. It's the blood of Jesus that does. And then it's that when you make that statement, baptism is just the indication of your public profession of what you did privately and being obedience to his word of following Christ. That's just saying you're not ashamed of Jesus. That's why we do that, signifying his death, burial, resurrection. Why am I even talking about baptism here? I don't have a baptism today. Maybe I'm wanting one. You know, I'll have old Brian filling that baptistry before you know it. We'll get it all set up again. We go in spells. We do that. That's the thing, seems like, as we do that. Hey, you saw the screens and the announcements and things coming up. You have it here in your bulletin highlighting the various things that are taking place this week, activities and things. So mark that down. You are welcome to be a part of any of these things that are there. And men, I think it's up on the screens, but not in the bulletin. We're going to have our start back with our men's Bible study and breakfast on the 25th, the last Saturday. I'm looking right at my cooks. last Saturday at 9 a.m. Be here, boys. So we'll get the books to you, and we'll do a little review. And, of course, you won't be able to do your study. It takes you, we'll have them for a month. We'll meet monthly. If you have not been with us, we are inviting you to come. So any of the men and boys, we have some that are men becoming, boys becoming men, and then we got a few men that's boys, you know. But we have a good time, and we want to invite you Saturday the 25th of March at 9 a.m. for breakfast and Bible study to do that. So you can read the bulletin for the other things that are listed there, and we thank you for coming today, and let's go to the Lord in a word of prayer. Father, you're so good to us, and we thank you for your sweet, sweet Holy Spirit, and for your Son, Jesus, our Savior. You know those that are watching today, and those of us that are here, and those that couldn't be here for whatever reasons. Father, you know those that are sick and lost loved ones. We pray for your comfort. We pray for guidance for our nation, Lord, that we can come back to you. And starting right here, this morning, right now, as we join together in worshiping you, Father, touch our hearts that we glorify Jesus, in whose name we pray. Amen.
Good morning, everybody. It's good to see everybody out in the sunshine. Sun coming up early this morning. The days are getting longer. Hopefully it'll wake you all up like me. Come out of our winter hibernation. In Revelation 4:8, John tells us in heaven about four created beings. They have six wings and they're full of eyes. And their only purpose, their created purpose, is to worship God day and night. They say, "Holy, holy, holy, Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come." And how profound is that when you think about all those beings in heaven that are created? And it boggles your mind to think about what it's going to be like when we get there and see all these things. Anybody else want to come up and sing with us? Everybody's welcome. We'll start out standing. Holy, holy, holy.
Oh, yeah.
worship with us through song. Okay?
Thank you, Miss Lauren. Thank you, choir. And I just want to say a special thank you to my sweet wife that does such a fine job of filling in for us every Sunday. And that I just appreciate her so much. I really do. That's a you know we've been praying and looking, and we just God hasn't sent someone to us to lead our music and things, except the fact that my dear wife, it just continues to plug right in there and to do it. She's not looking, and being that she's just willing to volunteer and give her services to do that, to serve the Lord. So until the Lord shows us different, that's just the way it is. I guess that's right, isn't it? If you have your Bibles, I'd like for you to open them, if you would, please, to 1 Kings. And we'll be sharing in chapter 8 in 1 Kings again. Today, as we look at the scripture, part 2 of last Sunday's sermon. The title of the message was, It Was Good That It Was In Your Heart. And when we looked at, just for a review, a brief review, for those of you that were not here, Solomon is preparing in 1 Kings chapter 8, verse 12 through 21, of preparing and building. He's building the temple, something his dad, who is no longer living, had passed away, and Solomon was anointed as the king over Israel and Judah, and fulfills the promise or the desire within the heart of his dad to build a temple for God, a place, something more beautiful than the tent, the tabernacle, and all the different things. That it was just something that was in his heart. And so he does that, and in looking at it, God removes, before that time, we did a little review to find out how David came to that position, because Saul was the first king, and he sinned, he disobeyed the Lord, and he was removed from the throne, and God sent Samuel to the house of Jesse, and there was 8 sons, and it was David. After everybody was on display, that God said, he's the one. He was a little fella, kind of a Rudy, but a handsome little dude. He was really good. I mean, he wasn't afraid of anything. He said he fought bears, lions. He delivered the lambs from them, all the different things. And God said, he's the one. Samuel anoints him, and the Spirit of the Lord comes upon him. He also plays music. And he was playing instruments, and so happened that when the Spirit of God had left Saul, I can tell you, when the Spirit of God leaves you, dear friend, when you quench the Spirit of God, when you grieve the Holy Spirit within your life, when sin once again is having dominion over you, whether it's guilt or whatever that comes within your life, I can promise you misery. The Bible says the way of a transgressor is hard. And whatever that is within each of our lives. And so Saul faced dark days, the first king. His battles he was losing. He couldn't get people to fight for him. He couldn't, all the different things. In fact, there was a giant of the Philistines named Goliath. And he taunted them. And it was during that time that we see David, who before we didn't see all the different things, that here God picked him out. It wasn't something someone else would pick out to say, he would be my choice. We do that for presidents. You know, we do that for everything. And say, he'd be my choice. That's the one I want for this position. I'm not so much interested anymore in what you want, I want, or whatever. I'd like to know what God wants. And so, in the process, some of his servants said to Saul, and this is our review, they said, well, you know, find somebody to play a little music. So I guess music could be soothing to the soul. Depends on what kind of music you might listen to. But all music, it can be soothing to the soul. You know, I grew up on country. I like bluegrass. I like rock and roll. I like good Christian gospel. I like contemporary. I like the old hymns. I like, if it's praising God, I like it. Makes me feel better. I like that too. Come on, amen, you know that's true. We listen to the stuff that we enjoy, do we not? Things that we like, something that makes us feel good, that's comforting. Whether it's a symphony, where's my little pianist? Right there, the Springfield Symphony is playing just classical music, different things. It's so soothing, so special in our lives that does it. So guess who had the music ability? And they found David. He comes in the house of Saul. He plays the harp. And before you know it, David is out there fighting Goliath. He hears about his taunts and stuff. So we look at that, and David defeats Goliath, and Saul eventually dies. David is anointed and put up for king. And David wins all these battles, and he's finally at the point to where he's like, I want to do something for God. And that's where we go to. That was the person we described. Let's look at the person. What is it to have a good heart? Look at verse 18 with me in verse 8 there. In chapter 8, verse 18. And the Lord said unto David, my father, this is Solomon speaking to the people, whereas it was in thine heart to build a house unto my name, thou didst well. that it was in thine heart. May the Lord add the blessing to the reading of his word and grant understanding today to our hearts as we, part of a message is not just understanding what took place then, but the application for now. How does that relate to me? Because you see, the Bible is the living word. And when we hear stories about how God acted and what in places of people and things, that when we come to church, we come to worship the living God. We come to join in together. So what is it that God is saying to me? What is he saying right now, whether you're listening on Facebook Live or streaming or whatever, or right here in church, back of the church, the front, what is it that as I come in together, what is it that God has to say to me? Now, it could be that God is saying, I'm waiting to see what you have to say to me because I've already spoken. And it may be in response as to what it is here in your heart, because this is what we're going to look at today and wrap up in this message. What is in your heart? You see, it's important because God knows every person's heart. And what I noticed in the scripture here that Solomon was saying about his dad is that his dad, David, wanting to do something for God, you know, not for himself, but wanting to do something for God. What is it that you've done for the Lord? Well, you got saved. You did that for yourself. I got saved. That was part of the benefits of eternal life, salvation, and forgiveness of our sins. In fact, we may not have. I know people who have desires to give. I've known people in communities that were not saved who sponsored or helped the church. They'd send donations, and where I'd pastored, they own businesses or things, and they say, just want to give a little something to the church because we were active in the community. There was things that we wanted to just kind of help out a little bit. And I could see, you know, there was different things that people have a desire. You see, God knows the heart. Whether we do, whether we don't, or whatever takes place, it's important to know this because he knows every person's heart. And that's just not mine. That covers everyone. There's not one secret, not anything not known. And the indication there is of what you really are. It really tells who you are, what you are, by the sense of what's here within your heart. Listen to what the Bible says in Matthew chapter 15, verse 11. Jesus says, not that which goeth into the mouth defiles a man, but that which cometh out of the mouth that defiles a man. What is it that comes out of the mouth? Think about this for a moment with me, if you would. Do you see people spewing poison out of their mouths? You know, just saying negative things, saying curse words, anger. Do you see people? You say, Jesus, what did he say? It's not what goes in. Go ahead and eat that steak or those vegetables or those salads, whatever you want to eat. It's not what goes in that defiles you. It's what's proceeding out of your mouth that is coming. So what is curses and swearing and lying and all the different things to say? And you say, well, we're talking about lost people. No, we're talking about everyone. We're talking about when you see that this is the problem, the corruption that comes with hate speech and everything else that comes in, you see, that doesn't have any color at all. That doesn't have any nationality at all. It is looking in on whatever. You can go to whatever country, wherever you want to go to, whatever people, whatever race or nation, and it breaks away the economic part of being rich or being poor because it's coming from here, from the heart, into the mouth. And we hear so much of what people are saying, it really is describing you. You go around and, you know, I'll tell you, I was a Christian, and I quit for a little while when I got saved, that cussing and my temper and things like that and trying to run and even the drinking to a point. And then you kind of find yourself kind of backsliding a little bit here and there. And when you hear enough people say, well, you can't be perfect as a Christian. And so sometimes I hear that and I just can let it go, you know. And then I go into one thing and into another. Before you know it, I get a little bit more loose with how I live and what I do as a Christian, and a little more comfortable with, you know, I don't have to be down to church, for example, being saved. I could lose the emphasis or importance of what it means to be in the house of God. You know, we can talk about all these things because we find ways of justifying our actions of how we live, how we talk, or not, whatever, believing, all these different things. And I remember that when I got into that part, when I really got serious, when God called me and I really surrendered on September the 17th, 1974, to the ministry. And I mean, God put me through the briars and bramble and all of the different things of going through in my life, being locked up in jail and had a gun to my head and all the things, the sinful things in my life. That happened when I was saved. You was locked up in jail when you were saved? I was. I was celebrating Christmas. Oh, excuse me. That's supposed to be funny, but it's not real funny. Yeah. And I had two businesses when I had money. I was doing great. Eight guys working for me at the age of 23, 22. When I got to the place, but getting down, but you know, everything else can be when you're miserable inside and stuff, and I fit in with all the old guys in the blend. But what was coming out of here, out of my mouth, did not reflect really all the different things, because I knew the Lord and I was ashamed and I just couldn't stop. I kept getting worse and worse because I kept saying no. Do you know that's the trouble Saul got into? It's because he disobeyed God. Samuel said it's better to obey than to make sacrifices. It's better to obey from the heart of what God tells you how to live and how to serve Him rather than what you're giving or doing all this, that you should obey the Lord. So listen to God in your heart of what God tells you and how to live, but it's going to be scriptural. It's not one of my, me and the Lord got this thing worked out deal. Just for a convenience for you or for me, right? Oh, I've had plenty of people try to tell me that one, sell me on that one, you know. Well, God, he understands. It's like, let's make a deal thing on the TV show. You're thinking God's up here and says, hey, come on down, you know, so let's just make a deal right here. You know, what is it that, no, God is consistent. It's the same for everybody. You have to repent of your sins. You have to confess your sins before the Lord. And you're not going to get into heaven unless you open your heart up through that repentance and confession and invite Jesus into your heart and you truly get saved and your life is changed and this old fleshly heart, stony heart that is changed here to a new heart. And then you'll start talking and acting right within your life. If you don't, you're going to be the most miserable person just like me. Because that was the thing that was happening in my life, that you dispute all those. It's what comes out that defiles you. And the Lord kept warning me. He kept calling me. And finally, I think he said, this is it, Odell, on that Sunday night, September the 17th, 1974. This is it. You know, there is a sin unto death, the Bible says. Now, that's not the blasphemy of the Holy Ghost. That's the unpardonable sin. I'm talking about sins that you and I as Christians can commit. There is that sin when we disobey God and continue on and on and on and on, and God brings you to that place within your life, you've heard Him, and you know, and you even tell yourself, I shouldn't have said that. I can tell you, when you lay that down at the foot of the cross, when you repent, listen, when you're saying something, you ought to correct yourself right then. When you're doing something, you ought to correct yourself right then. Not wait till later on or go on and act like it's okay and that you have permission from God to do that, because what happens is it's an indication. If your heart is really good, listen to what Jesus said in defining in Matthew 15, verse 18. But those things which proceed out of the mouth comes forth from the heart, and they defile the man. It was his exclamation to his apostles, his disciples. He is clarifying to them what was taking place. Proverbs 23, verse 7 says, as he thinketh in his heart, so is he. Listen to a story that Jesus gave in Matthew chapter 12, verse 9 through verse 15. And when he was departed thence, he went into their synagogue, and behold, there was a man which had his hand withered. Now, Jesus is going to church. He goes into the synagogue. There's a man there that his hand is withered, and this is on the Sabbath, on Saturday, the day that they believe was to worship, according to the Old Testament. This was true. And they ask him, these are those that are there, ask him, Jesus, saying, is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath days? And then you'll notice that they might accuse him. Do you see that? The ulterior motive of what people, sometimes of what they do right there in church, that here they were saying, they were asking him, is it lawful? They looked at this poor man. They weren't doing anything about it. In fact, their law forbid them to do such a thing. They restricted themselves as to believe that the day was more important than the one who made the day. And they were looking at that, and so they tried to find a way. This was the deception. This was the evil within their heart. Look at it next. And he said unto them, what man shall there be among you that has one sheep, and if it fall into a pit on the Sabbath day, will he not lay hold on it and lift it out? Every one of them, I'm sure, wealthy, had their sheep. He made an analogy of a farming exhibition, said, oop, they went down the hole. The sheep couldn't get out of the ditch. And he said, you'll reach down. Oh, wait a minute. It's Saturday. Poor old sheep's going to die in that pit. I hate losing that little lamb. No emphasis is made on the importance of a person's life. So many times over the going on 40, well, it's been 48 years, be 49 years this year in ministry, going to churches and finding where people so ritualistically and traditionally that we get caught up somehow or another into the forms of our religion. As the Bible says, we have a form of religion, but we deny the power thereof. We come in, we go through these things, and we overlook the real needs of people around us, even as we're coming to church or to do whatever to see that what's important. Some people, you say, you ever heard this one say, oh, I can't mow my yard on Sunday. You know, what's people going to say? You know, because we're making like an emphasis to say, well, I can't do this. I can't go fishing. I can't play golf on Sunday. I can't do this or that because this is the Lord's day. Yes, that is correct. It is the Lord's day. But to come to a place to bind you up in a lawful way, to say if something was necessary, Jesus showed if there's something that really has to be done, is the ox in the ditch? Now, I didn't give you permission to go fishing, miss church. If you do that, you have to deal with that with God. That's okay. You don't need my permission anyway. Or to play golf. Or to do whatever you do, or to miss it, whatever, because it is in the heart we do what we want to do. This is the emphasis of saying that we choose, we pick, we know, and it is a reflection of the heart. These guys were in church, and here they had this problem. They was asking him, says, you know, is it lawful to hear? Right here's the man. Is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath day? And Jesus says, which of you? And about the sheep. And then he goes on in verse 12. How much better then is a man than a sheep? Wherefore it is lawful, get this, to do well on the Sabbath days. It's lawful to do. It's always right. Listen to me. It's always right to do right. Always. Always right to do right. And sometimes in doing right, sometimes we can mistake the fact of our hearts. It's to live right. It's always right to speak right. It's all those different things because God knows your heart. In fact, in James 4:17 says, to him that knows to do good and does it not, to him it is, you know it. In verse 13, then saith he to the man, stretch forth thine hand. And he stretched it forth, and the Bible says it was restored whole like as the others. Look at verse 14. Then the Pharisees went out. Now these Pharisees, that is the religious sect of the Jews. These are people, let's say they're Baptists or they're Methodists, they're Catholic, whatever you want to pick and choose to say, these were the movers and shakers. They had a lot of laws. They were very self-righteous. Then the Pharisees, they were lawyers. In fact, the Apostle Paul, or Saul, was a Pharisee. Then in verse 14, the Pharisees went out and held a council against him how they might destroy him. Before, it said that they might, in verse 10, accuse him. And now it's how they might destroy him in verse 15. But when Jesus knew it, he withdrew himself from thence, and great multitudes followed him. And I want you to notice this particularly, and he healed a few. It's the Sabbath day. He healed them all. If you're sick, if you're withered, if you're in pain, or you're struggling or whatever, notice here was one man that it started out with, and then they accuse him, they want to destroy him. Now the people are just saying, you can't, they're talking down, but notice that all of these followed him, and this happened outside of the church. It was in the church, in the synagogue, when Jesus said, reach out your hand, and the man was healed. You thought, man, they would have had that Asbury revival going on. Woo, hallelujah, praise the Lord. Look, I just got healed, you know, doing this. Instead, here they were looking like, and like, oh, we can't have that in our church. That's not how we are. That's not the kind of people that we are. We got, you know, we got to shut this thing down. And so they start going out. It says Jesus knew it, and you'll notice in Matthew 12, verse 25, Jesus knew the thoughts of their heart. And the reason was their hearts were evil continually. It said there, Jesus knew their thoughts, Matthew 12, 25, and he said unto them, every kingdom divided against itself is brought to desolation. Every city, house divided against itself shall not stand. Brother Odell, what does that mean? If you have a divided heart, you will be destroyed. If your heart really, truly isn't fixed upon the Lord Jesus Christ. James chapter 1, verse 8 says a double-minded man is unstable in all of his ways. To have a divided heart is to, you can't make decisions, you can't follow. There are many people that come to, I can't for the life of me understand why. If you know you're lost, then you know you need to be saved. If you're saved and you're out of step with God, you know you need to confess, you need to repent, you need to get back closer to the Lord. Amen. That when you know this within your heart, we know these things to him that knows do good is what? Sin. So for the life of me, I can't understand to say that when we within our hearts here know these things, it's good that God knows our heart, isn't it? And because he knows our heart, he extends grace. He extends his mercy. He shares with us in times, but we don't know when that grace and that mercy is going to run out. What if you happen to die? I've had this one asked. Said, what if me, I'm saved, but what if I die and I haven't repented of the sin that I as a Christian have committed within my life? What if here it is and I know and I'm struggling, but I've intended to do right. Rewind back real fast. There's a sin unto death. Says the Bible says, but I don't say that you are to pray for it. What is that sin? That sin is whatever you keep doing, you keep doing, you keep doing, I keep doing, that keeps us from him, from being what he wants us to be. But we say, I'm weak, but I embrace it, it's my pet, it's whatever, it's what I like to do. It's even though I know I'm saved, I've given my life to Christ, but I keep going on through this thing. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 1 says, children, obey your parents, for this is right in the Lord, that your days may be long. Now, what was it that I said earlier that Saul got in trouble for? Disobedience? We are the children of God. And as God's children, God expects us to obey Him. He desires for us, it pleases Him when we obey Him. We have His Word that speaks to our hearts. We have preaching. We have songs. The Holy Spirit is speaking to each of us within because it's the Holy Spirit here that is guiding us. Jesus said, you'll have the Holy Spirit. He will guide you into all truth. You'll know all these different things. You'll do those things that pleases God. We can't have a divided heart. You can't serve God and mammon too. I've tried that. I've done that. Some of you are doing it right now. In fact, there's more of us probably doing it right now than aren't. Hello, oh me. But there's some things in our hearts that say, because there are none of us perfect, but we ought to strive for the protection of, for the perfection of pleasing the Lord within our life, wanting to do for the Lord. I want to do more for the Lord. That are to be every one of us's heart. I want to do more. I want to be a better witness for the Lord. I want to be a better servant for the Lord. I want to do that, to have that within my heart. Are there some things in your life that you did because you wanted to? Guilty. Never thought to consult God? Guilty. Maybe like many of us, we ask the family members, we ask friends, and we try to just do it on our own. Most of the time, our attention is focused on what others think or say rather than focused upon what God thinks. I think we need to pay attention to what God says because it matters now and it matters eternally what God says. In 2 Samuel chapter 7, verse 1 through 13, David the king and Nathan the prophet get into trouble by doing something that God did not tell them to do, and they got ahead of him. So here you have the king, here you have the prophet of God. The prophet of God wants to be pleasing to his king and to do whatever. And it says in 2 Samuel chapter 7, verse 1, and it came to pass when the king sat in his house and the Lord had given him rest around about from all of his enemies. This is what I was telling you earlier as we started out. That the king said unto Nathan the prophet, see how I dwelled in a house of cedar, but the ark of God dwelleth within curtains. And Nathan said to the king, go and do all the things that's in thy heart, for the Lord is with thee. David, after all the wars and the fighting, and they were wealthy, and built a big, beautiful house. Cedars from Lebanon and places their homes, and even now they were no longer living in tents, and they had the city that's built up. Steps out on his balcony, and he looks down close to his home, that tabernacle that's tattered with the tents, the coverings flapping in the wind, and the Ark of the Covenant of God, the most precious thing that is representative of God, is there in that tabernacle. It was a tabernacle that was designed by God that the Levites would have to carry. All the other tribes would have to do the warring, but it was the Levites that they were assigned, and all priests came out of the Levitical tribe, but not all Levites were priests. They all had workings. They had things that they were to do. They were assigned, just like the other country, families that was in there, in part of that, Simeon and whatever, all the different tribes, the 12 tribes. But the Levites were assigned particularly to handle and to deal. And Aaron was, of course, Moses' brother and was priest. And they were all given these descriptions of what they were to do and how to handle the things. So all that time, God was with them through that. They carried that Ark of the Covenant. And they would roll up that tent, and they would carry them on poles and things, and they'd reset it back up when they got somewhere else because they wanted to be in the presence of God. But when that ark was stolen many years later, And years before this time, this is what made it so special to David, is because when that ark was brought back, David went and he danced in the streets half naked, dancing in the streets because of the glory of God coming back, bringing it back there to the city of David. And as they built that city and all the different things, the excitement of having the ark, they wanted now to give glory and honor to God for all he had done. And David says, I want to build a house for the Lord. Not right that this is the way it ought to be for us. So he says this, and Nathan says, go ahead and do it. You better pray about something. The Bible tells us, James in chapter 4 says, that we are to say, Lord willing, I'll do this or that. You know, in James chapter 4. Don't say, I'm going into town to buy or sell tomorrow. Say, Lord willing, for you know not what tomorrow may bring, it says in James chapter 4, because life is like a vapor that appears for a short time and then vanishes away. Say, Lord willing. But Nathan said, do what's in your heart. So David's going to build this house for the Lord. But something changes. Look at verse 5 in 2 Samuel chapter 7, or verse 4. It came to pass when that night, do you see it? Oh, Nathan told David, said, it's all right. Go ahead and do what you want to. It says, but the word of the Lord came to Nathan. Do you notice that? You're just so much better off when you know God told me I could do this. God said, why are you doing this? Because that's what God called me to do. The Lord has led me to do that. I see so many people say that over the years, and they say, God, Pastor, God's leading me to, we're gonna build a picnic shelter. And to do that, I said, well, we need a picnic shelter. And I said, if the Lord's leading you, have at it. Before long, I know this guy's berating everybody else because they aren't helping him build that picnic shelter out there. And I said, well, if God told you to do it, why are you upset because they're not doing it? Until he tells them to do whatever, respect the fact that God may be telling them to do something different. But it's a real test of time to show if God shows you to do it. But if God didn't really tell you and it's just something you want to do, you hearing me? If it's a way that you want to do it or whatever, you say, I'm going to do this. Expect, because there's a way, the Bible says, that seems right to a man, but the end thereof is death. God's ways are not our ways. And so all at once, here's this preacher, I can just see him. He's gone home, he's in good with the king. He goes home and reading in 2 Samuel chapter 7. And I'm just going to summarize this for you and not read those scriptures on it. And he goes and he tells Nathan about, he said, I didn't tell you to build that house. I went through, and he goes describing, he says, I went through all these things and said, I went through with the time packing up the tent. I dwelled in the tent with the Ark of the Covenant and all that thing. That Ark of the Covenant represented the power of God. It wasn't the power of God. The cross on our wall. As we look at the cross, Jesus is off that cross. But that's not the power of God. The power of God is the Lord Jesus Christ. He's the one that came off that cross. He's the one that rose from that grave. It's indication of God's power of what happens and the Holy Spirit within us. Acts 1:8. But when he comes into you, you shall receive power to be witnesses unto me. It's power beyond ourselves of whatever happened. So God preaches a little sermon to Nathan in the following verses and tells him, says, now I want you to go back, he said, to David. I want you to say this in verses 8. He says, now therefore thou shalt say unto thy servant David, thus saith the Lord of hosts, I took you from the sheep's pen, from following the sheep to be a ruler over my people and over Israel. And he goes on talking, I was with you in all these different things and everything, and blessed you and led you in the battles and win the victories and etc. And the children that went through the wilderness and they dealt wicked things and was merciful and graceful and all the different things. And God says, I'll choose where my house is going to be and where I'm going to dwell and what I'll do and who's going to build it for me. And then he mentioned the fact, he said, it'll be an heir from your seed. It won't be you because blood is on your hands. And there was a limitation that was put upon David. And this is what brought the picture of the whole thing of the Bible, that God says, you can't, there are things that we do within our lives, dear friends, that oftentimes sets limitations. Things are not always the same of what they always were. But I am so glad for the grace and mercy of God. You know, we go through hurt and troubles and all kinds of pain and different things like that. And old David went out and he bought a piece of land that the guy wanted to donate it. And David said, no, I will not give the Lord that which costs me nothing. Come on now. It's right here. When your heart is right with God, that whatever you do, you will be set to be into motion to try to do the right thing to the best you can. And when, like, I've experienced it myself, when I don't, I am readily and quickly. I want to get on my knees or I want to bow my head and I say, Lord, I'm sorry, I shouldn't have said that. I shouldn't have done that. Or, Lord, I should have done that. You told me and I didn't listen. And so then he said, you go back and tell David this in my message. And so he did. And as he went back and he told me, he said, God said in verses 12 and 13 of the scripture, they said, I will set up the seed after thee, which will proceed out of thy bowels. I will establish his kingdom, and he shall build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. So let me ask you, who really gets the credit for having a good heart? Is it the person who says he'll do something for the Lord and don't? Or is it the person who said, I won't, but he actually does? Let's read this passage of Scripture and we'll close today. Matthew 21, verse 28. But what thank you? A certain man had two sons, Jesus says. And he came to the first and said, son, go to work today in my vineyard. And the son answered and said, I will not. But afterward he repented and went. And he came to the second son and said, likewise. And he answered and said, I go, sir, and went not. Whither of them twain did the will of his father? This is Jesus asking the Pharisees. They say unto him, well, the first. Jesus said unto them, verily I say unto you, that the publicans and the, now that's not republicans now, okay. The publicans and the harlots go into the kingdom of God before you. That's pretty strong. Look at verse 32. And Jesus gave the reason. He says, for John, this is John the Baptist, John came unto you in the way of righteousness, and you believed him not. You remember when he came out and he was baptized and the whole city came out and he was preaching, hell, fire, and damnation. Repent, he was preaching. He says, the axe lies at the root of the tree. It's cutting it down. The tree is about to fall. And he was preaching. It was before Jesus stepped on the scene. He's the cousin to Jesus. And John the Baptist preached, and all the Pharisees and all the city was coming out. I tell you, John was loud. He had no microphone. But man, the word of God was getting out, and he was the last prophet of the Old Testament, here in the New Testament, born by a miracle, the cousin to the Lord Jesus Christ. And Jesus said, John came unto you in the way of righteousness. He was preaching righteousness and calling for repentance, and you believed him not. You heard the message. You knew what to do, and you didn't do it. It didn't fit into your plans. It didn't go along with what you say, I believe, how I was raised up. I want to tell you, if God's Word shows you that the things that you learned when you was a kid or how you used to do things or the tradition of all that, or say this church believes that, you need to throw that in the shredder, put it in the garbage can, do away with it. When God says clearly what it takes to get into the kingdom of heaven, I'm going to believe Him. And He said, you know, John came to you in the way of righteousness, and you believed him not, but the publicans and the harlots believed him. And ye, when you had seen all this done, repented not afterward, that you might believe on him. The key, the word, is the repentance of the heart. That when you come to see it, to know they in their heart were hungry and longing. But here there's so many people that are so, if you're so full today of all the things of your own self-righteousness and all the things in your life, we need revival in the church. We need revival in our spirits as we come to a place, and revival should be an ongoing thing within our life. That is to be revived, to be refreshed, to be renewed in the walk of God's Spirit within our life. It starts with every individual. You know what you need to do. God may say to you, you're not really saved. Or God may say, you need to be saved. Of course, if you're not really saved, you need to be. The Holy Spirit will convict you. He'll show you. If you have to ask the question to know, then you probably aren't. That if you really don't know, because the Bible says in 1 John 5:13, these things are written that you may know that you have eternal life. God will do what He says He'll do. So when you look at your heart, do you have a good heart? Do you know what it means to do well? Not just say it, but act upon it. King David was actually going to build the temple he wanted to build for God. He actually was going to do it. I think it's extraordinary that his heart wasn't satisfied with what they, Israel, had, with what they were giving God. I think that's the thing we have to do. There are several things that we can do. We can give God our life. That's the most important thing. Our soul, our spirit, our heart. But it's our time, our talents, our tithes, or whatever. Giving as the Lord has blessed you. Giving as you can. You let God. No preacher, no church. That's not meant. That is because that indicates your heart of what you have for God when you're giving. And I promise you, as with David, that you will see God blessing you and remembering you, because He can see, even if you can't do it now, but if it's really in your heart to do the right thing, it'll come out, won't it? It'll come out. We've discovered in the message, David had to alter his plans, settling to buy the land for the temple that would be built on. So what is it that God is saying to you in your life? What does He see in your heart right now that He's asking maybe you, me, that we need to do? If He looked at, I hope He would, I believe He would, to say it. I have said for a long time, I love people and I love God. And I've tried to preach over the years and say, you know, I fail. I don't ever ask anybody to try to be perfect or doing whatever, trying to get caught up into things of churchy things like this. I've pastored churches where they thought I had to wear a tie all the time in order to look like a preacher, and I'd get people complaining because I didn't. They'd be doing all this thing. Do you notice the people, the different things in Jesus in the Bible, that He knew their hearts? They looked for ways to accuse Him. They looked for ways to destroy Him. But you know, the people of God are supposed to encourage one another. Hebrews 10:25, forsake not the assembling of yourself as the manner of some is, but exhorting one another, building up each other, so much more as you see the day approaching. Open your heart today and let God lead you. Pray. Thank you, Father, for your wonderful word, for the sweet Holy Spirit, for our Savior who shed his blood upon the cross and arose from the grave and is preparing a place for us right now and is coming soon. Thank you that you speak to our hearts and guide us. You know our hearts. And Lord, if our heart isn't what it needs to be, change it. Make it new. Make it better. As we hear your call, we open our hearts and invite you in to do what needs to be done today. And whatever decision is made today, may it be to your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's stand together as we sing in our invitation today. And as God speaks to your heart, you're in the back of the church, the front, the middle. Step out. Come on. If you need to come around this altar, speak to me, whatever. If you join in the fellowship of this church, whatever God leads you to do, you come, you obey him. Let's sing.
The Savior is waiting to enter.
You can be the first. Just follow him. God's speaking to your heart. You're coming to join the fellowship of this church. Moving your letter here. Joining. Rededicating your life.
To see if you're willing to open the door.
Let's do it one more time. This will be the last verse unless someone else comes. Let's just really lift it up.
Time after time, he has waited before, and now he is waiting again.
Are you listening?
To see if you're willing to open the door. Oh, how he wants.
All God's people said, amen. Amen. Would you be seated for just a moment, please? Sister Pat, would you come up here with me, honey? Thank you so much. This is Miss Pat. We got to know each other. Oh, it's been, gosh, one time there you came back maybe a year ago, and then you're looking and praying about where the Lord wanted to lead you to. And came back. She's been here several times regularly now, and she comes this morning, and said the Lord was leading her to join our fellowship, want to be a part of Orchard Crest Baptist Church. And so if you join me in welcoming her, you say amen, smile.
Amen.
Amen. You want to say something, your church family, Pat?
No.
Most people don't. You already say it when you come up here, you know. I mean, that's good. Pat's last name is
B-I-L-Y-E-U.
B-I-L-Y-E-U. Ballou?
Mm-hmm.
Ballou. Is that Louisiana?
I think it's French.
They say, we might be kin at Beauchamp, you know. I never tell them, everybody knows me as Beecham, you know, but it looks like Beauchamp, you know, I never mentioned. And so my son says that's what he prefers. He likes that French name, make us more important, you know. That is so beautiful name, Pat. We're so glad to have you, dear. And anything we can do for you, we'll look forward to doing it, okay? And help you. So if you'd like, you can go back, get your stuff, and maybe meet me at the door and where people can greet you as they go out today. And we'll let you do that. All right. It's so good to be here, isn't it? Man, what a good crowd today that we're having. And I'm going with this wild, crazy gang today sometimes. And maybe I'll give you a review next week. We'll tell you. But we're going to see. What is the Jesus Revolution? We're going to go see that new movie that's come out. They say it's pretty awesome. So we might want to check that out later on. But I hope you have a great day. Remember, Wednesday night we start Farside Chat. We ended our Bible study in Philippians on Wednesday night this past week. I'll do Farside Chat for a Wednesday or two to answer any questions that you may have. We'll go back into that for a little bit. And then while we're looking towards another Bible study time that we're doing that. So that will happen when you run out of questions. And that will, you remember what Farside Chat is. And there's no boundaries, no limit. You come in, if you got questions, you ask, we answer. Right off the bat, we have a fellowship time together. We've discussed it, whether it was politics, whether it was in the Bible. Of course, everything with me, if it was politics, is in the Bible. But we'll answer it from biblical perspectives to help answer any questions or concerns that you have as a Christian, or whether it's about our church, about the Bible, certain verses, or whatever. Okay, so we'll do that starting, if you haven't been involved and you might like to, then that will take place 6:30 Wednesday night. All right, my dear, I'll turn it over to you and you can lead us a song. So let's stand back up to our feet as we're dismissed with song.
Everybody, let's just rejoice our way out the door here.